Hi guys and girls of YouTube land, it's just me, Jamie, and Phoenix. She is working on going to sleep. She had her binky in her mouth and, she has decided that she didn't want to keep it in her mouth anymore. So she might start fussing and I have to pause. I apologize for my lack of makeup and my hair being a mess, but it's 1:30 in the morning. I just have a lot on my mind and I wanted to touch base on some of that stuff and vent a little bit. One major thing I want to talk about is cystic fibrosis. That is something that, has become an everyday part of our life. And I'll touch more on that in the future, I'm sure. she's a little fidgety tonight. Anyway, I want to talk more about cystic fibrosis and I'll explain why in a minute. And then I want to vent about taxes a little bit. I'll start with that. Because it's money's a big stressor for me, and obviously this is a weight loss channel for the most part for now. I've been working so hard at making more mindful choices with my food intake, and I feel like I've done okay. There have been some struggles, but I've stuck really hard to my protein. If you hear any little fart noises, I'm so sorry. I promise it's not me. It's the baby. She's one of the gassiest kids I've ever met in my entire life. And it's mostly the CF that we deal with that causes the gas. But anyway, so let me start with the taxes. We filed our taxes tonight because we finally got her social. And our taxes got declined immediately within like an hour. Apparently someone's already used one of our socials to file taxes. Jesus, kid. Sorry. And I have a feeling it's probably my husband's because his identity was stolen earlier last year. And it was probably like, not earlier, but it was like October, November maybe, somewhere in there. So I have a feeling even though we had a lock on his identity, not on his identity, but on his social security number, somebody somehow just filed his taxes. We got married in October, so I don't know how they didn't have access to his W-2. I definitely think that the government needs a better way for us to file our taxes so that, you know, we can prove that we are who we say we are, so that people are not taking advantage of those who work really hard for their money. It's frustrating because we need to move. Our house is a nice house, but we need a new one that's safe for Phoenix because this one's got leaks. It's, you know, we can't prove that it's got mold, but I'm fairly positive it's got mold in it. We just can't see it because it's not on an exposed part of the wall. We've had several leaks in the house. The insulation over both girls' rooms is atrocious and it's cold outside right now. So, luckily our in-laws bought us, I don't know if you can see, there's like a blue thing kind of in the center right above those two bottles, way in the background. It's a really nice Dyson fan / heater, and it's amazing, but they shouldn't have had to buy that for me. I mean, they did it because they love us and they care, and we probably could have afforded it, but it's just frustrating that I can't provide those things because of medical bills and other stuff that we're dealing with. But we can't afford to move right now because we need our taxes, and the money we would get from that would go towards paying off credit cards. And, you know, there's the home buyer or the home builder that we want to go through requires like $1,000 minimum down, and our credit sucks, but that's what they can do to work with us. And we can't have that now. We have a delay because we have to prove that we didn't file our taxes before this. And I'm hoping that the government, in its current state, will work with us. Because I don't know what we're going to do otherwise. Anyway, so that's my rant. There's not really much I can do about it at 1:30 in the morning. I'm going to get her to sleep and get her bottles made. And then we'll get up at 7, Scott and I, and we'll call and try to figure out whose social got used. And talk to the IRS if we can reach anybody. And see what we can do to fix it. So that's that. So my C CF, cystic fibrosis. Phoenix was diagnosed with that a couple of weeks ago, about 3 weeks ago now. Look at this kid. Hannah calls that Phoenix's poop dance. I think she might be hungry because she's trying to eat her hand. She literally just ate. So the reason I want to talk about cystic fibrosis is there's not a lot of parental or even kid talk about it on YouTube. And I feel like we talk about wanting a cure and we talk about wanting change. 1 minute, please. Sorry, I had to change angles. She was not comfortable. We'll see how long this lasts because she's got a binky and she keeps spitting it out. Hold on a minute. Take the binky. Take your bink. Sorry, guys. She probably won't want that. We'll see how long that lasts. If that doesn't work, we're gonna go ahead and make a bottle. So, cystic fibrosis, when you do some research, there's a girl named Claire Wineland. If you look her up on YouTube, she is no longer living. She passed away from cystic fibrosis last year. I followed her well before I found out about Phoenix, and she was so full of life, and she was so inspiring for someone who had such a debilitating disability. And I hate to call it a disability because people with cystic fibrosis, from what I've seen, are very able-bodied. They just can't do certain things because of their lungs or their digestive systems. But it doesn't mean that they're disabled by any means. It limits and hurts them. But so many of those people that I've seen that have it and suffer from it, you can't tell that they're suffering because they have such a good spirit about them. Take your binky. Here you go. And I think that's the kind of kid we're going to have with Phoenix. She's just so strong-willed and stubborn. And she knows what she wants. She doesn't like it when you call her little. She gets frustrated. She gets angry. They were calling her little in the doctor's visit when we met her cystic fibrosis team. And every time they would call her that, she would get so mad and fuss. And I don't think that maybe she understood that, but it was just so ironic that when they would say that, that's when she would fuss. So that's the first I heard about cystic fibrosis, where I kind of understood the progression of the disease, but I still didn't really understand it, watching Claire's videos. And then, of course, you see it on TV every now and then. And there's even a movie called 5 Feet Apart coming out, I think in March, about the disease. Or it's built around the disease. I just feel like it's a shame that on this platform we don't see a lot of videos other than information from doctors about the disease. You don't see what families go through. And I think that for us to want a cure, we need to educate people about it. I'm still learning. I'm not going to give you 100% of the information that there is because there's so much, you know, there's more than 2,700 different mutations of the disease that can appear in people's blood. Phoenix has two different kinds. She has one mutation from her dad and one from me. We don't know which he has. I'm assuming he has the more common one. Both of the ones we have are common, but his is the most common. It's Delta F, as in Frank, 508. That is what he has. And then I have, I believe, it doesn't really have a name. It's like 1898, 1G to the A. It's weird. Both of those are, they cause issues with the pancreas. And eventually she'll have problems with her lungs if we're not careful. And even if we are careful, she very likely will. At some point, she will need a lung transplant, more than likely. She may not make it to a lung transplant. She may end up passing away before that. We don't know. It's really hard because there's so many different variants to the disease that it can really do anything it wants, and we don't know. We don't have a way to predict. But we do know from those two variants that she will have digestive problems. And I knew from the very beginning that she had digestive problems. And I told the doctors that. And I thought I was going crazy. And I have two other kids. You know, one of those kids is my biological child. So I know what's normal for babies and what's not normal for babies. And not even to mention the fact that I've worked in childcare before. You know, that was the beginning of first few jobs that I had was babysitting and working in daycares. I worked in daycares until I was pregnant with Hannah, and even after that when she was like a year old. So I know babies. And as a parent, you know when something's not right with your kids. So Phoenix, when she was born, she was hungry all the time. Like, that kid could put down some food. At first, it was, you know, every couple of hours. And I tried breastfeeding. Within the first 24 hours, she became dehydrated. So we started supplementing the breast milk with formula. And it turned into, because I couldn't make enough breast milk, we were really just supplementing with breast milk. So, like, she was getting maybe 3 ounces of breast milk a day, which I guess anything's better than nothing. I at least tried for the first month of her life to produce enough milk for her. But it took up so much of my time. And then when we finally got the diagnosis, I decided I needed to choose between taking care of myself, because she's going to get what she needs from the formula anyway. She needs her mom. I was spending so much time pumping because that was the best way for me to get breast milk at that point that I was having to go, okay, here, Scott, take the baby, or here, Hannah, help me with the baby. And I wasn't giving her the attention she needed. And I just felt like, even though everything I was doing was for her, I wasn't actually with her, which seems counterproductive. And I'm going to spend a lot of her life away from her anyway, because I'm going to be the one that's having to work, because she's on my insurance. So I want to spend as much time with her right now as I can before I have to go back. Sorry, I think I have chocolate on my face because I made a keto chocolate, and I don't know. I can't tell. Anyway, I'm going to pause in a minute to put her down. But, so she initially ate all the time. Instead of eating a 2-ounce bottle, she would have up to 6 ounces sometimes. And I knew that wasn't normal. Especially being a gastric sleeve patient, I think it makes you more aware of stomach sizes. There's no way a normal baby can eat 6 ounces in one sitting. And that's exactly what she did sometimes. Like, we would do a 3-ounce bottle, and then 30 minutes later, she'd have another 3 ounces. And it just didn't seem right. Her bowel movements, she would have a poopy diaper every single diaper. I think we had like 1 or 2 just wet diapers per day, which I also knew wasn't normal. It was really runny. It wasn't the right consistency. She was fussy all the time. It wasn't just normal colic. It wasn't just normal gas. And she did have a lot of gas. But I could tell she was not comfortable and she was hurting. And I just could not, as much as I wanted the pediatrician to listen, she's a wonderful pediatrician. We love her. She just didn't know at that point. Every baby, when they're born, is required to have a heel prick test. And they just take a little needle, make the baby bleed, and they take these 5 little samples of blood on paper. And the baby doesn't really feel it for very long. And they take the baby's foot up for a little bit. She stops bleeding. And they send that off to the state lab, and the state tests it. And then they report back if there's any abnormal findings. Within the first couple of weeks, Phoenix came back for thyroid problems, which the doctor told us was normal because she was a very low birth weight. She was 6 pounds, 1 ounce at birth. So we went ahead and went back and retested. I haven't gotten the results back from that yet, but she said they were normal. And just a week later, not even a week later, like 3 days later, we got a phone call that said that she tested positive for cystic fibrosis. When we found out about the thyroid problem, or possible thyroid problem, we looked on, on Scott's 23andMe account, because we both did one for Christmas 1 year, and he did the health, portion. He paid extra money to do the health section of the DNA test, and he tested positive as a carrier for cystic fibrosis. We didn't think anything of it. I didn't get told anything by my OBGYN or anybody. I've never been told by anybody that I'm a carrier for cystic fibrosis, so I had no clue. So I thought that can't be right. There's no way. She's probably just a carrier or something stupid. And we were a little worried, and I prayed about it, and you know, I just kind of had faith that it was going to come back negative. We had to go back and do a sweat test. They wrapped the baby's arm up in these little bandages to make her sweat, and they put her in these little plastic things with tubing underneath the bandages, and it has to stay there for like 45 minutes, I believe. One arm didn't get enough sweat, and we were told when we left that they didn't have enough sweat, but they were going to try anyway, and that we would probably have to come back in a month or two to do another test, maybe further away, just depending on how her sweat glands developed, because she was so little. We got home. I was exhausted, so I took a nap. I was still trying to pump at the time, and so Phoenix and I took a nap, and I was only down for like an hour, 45 minutes, maybe 2 hours, and Scott came in, and he was crying, and he said she has cystic fibrosis, and I thought, there's got to be a mistake. They said there wasn't enough sweat. He said her numbers were off the charts. So we went to meet with her team, and they confirmed it, and I kind of explained the things that I had been talking to her doctor about with her symptoms. Her digestive problems, the gassiness, the diarrhea, the constant hunger. She was born at such a low birth weight. She wasn't gaining as fast as she should have been. She was only at a month old. She was 7 pounds, 12 ounces, I think. Maybe less. It was somewhere around 7, 12. At her team meeting that we had for her cystic fibrosis team. Excuse me. So yeah, the goal was for her to be 8 pounds, by the 20th of February. They gave us 3 bottles of enzymes, which is these little beads that are inside of a capsule. For a baby her size, what you do is you take a little baby spoon, and they gave us a few of them. They are a wonderful team. We go to Texas Children's pulmonologists, and the team that they set up for us is just amazing. I can't say enough about them. They're so helpful. They're just a phone call away if I need anything, and they're wonderful. So they gave us those 3 bottles of the enzymes. They're very expensive. We're talking $500 or $600 a bottle for the ones that they gave us. And I can't imagine not having insurance and having... You need that as someone with cystic fibrosis. Yes, there's a legal team that helps people with that. But it just floors me that medication that you need to survive on is so expensive. And cystic fibrosis is not something that somebody chooses to be born with. It's, you know, she needs that so she can survive. She's a baby. It's not like she went out and did meth and now she has a problem with her body because of that, or she ate too much fat or ate wrong and she gave herself diabetes. You know, she's not obese, she's just a baby. I don't know. Anyway, so they gave us the enzymes. We're supposed to give her, when we came home, we would put a little bit of applesauce on one of those spoons, and just regular unsweetened applesauce, and then put 1 capsule of the enzymes on that spoon and feed it to her. And you would think that she wouldn't take it, but she sucked it right up. She was starving. We didn't realize she was, even though we were feeding her plenty of food, she wasn't getting any nutrition. She was essentially starving the whole first month of her life because she wasn't getting what she needed because her pancreas wasn't helping her digest her food right. So those enzymes helped her to do that. I could tell a difference in the first 24 hours. She immediately went down to 2-ounce bottles. Her stools became normal baby poop. She'd have 3 or 4 poopy diapers every day instead of every single diaper being poop. We're talking, it was like 8 or 9 and it went down to 3 or 4. And then we, had to do CPT therapy, which is just, I'm still learning the acronyms, chest percussion therapy. And you get this little tool. It looks like a really hard plastic thing, but it's really like squishy, like marshmallow squishy. But it's filled with air. Ours is pink and it looks like a little tiny cup with a handle on the end. And you take it and you pat the baby's chest, sides, and back for 3 minutes a side. Hold on. Sorry for the mess. My glasses are falling down. So we have to do that. And we have to do a breathing treatment with a nebulizer twice a day. The CPT therapy we do twice a day as well. And the nebulizer has albuterol in it. And that is to break up the mucus in her lungs. And the CPT therapy is basically airway clearance, and it's to also break up the mucus. Some of the moms on the cystic fibrosis pages say that they suction their babies. I have not done that yet. It's not something that they told me to do in the CF team meeting. I'm going to have to ask them next time because I haven't gotten anything yet. She's got some times where she has to clear her throat. Scott and I are very prone to allergies when the weather changes, and I have a feeling that she's going to be the same because Hannah is too. It's just been a wild, crazy ride. As soon as we started the albuterol, the next day she started getting leg tremors. So I called and spoke to her nurse yesterday, and the nurse said to stop the albuterol. Her doctor's out of town until Friday. So we're just doing the CPT therapy for now. But she was getting really bad tremors. She did gain weight. She went up to 8 pounds, 12 ounces. And then she went to 8 pounds, 15 and a half ounces. So she's just like a half ounce away from 9 pounds, which I'm going to call it 9 pounds while I can. And she sure feels like it. But because of that, her stomach started upsetting her again. She was very gassy. So we started having to give her 2 pills of the enzymes every time she eats a bottle. She can only have 16 of those pills per day. So we have to monitor how much she's getting. So usually if she wants to eat a little bit more, I'll let her eat a little bit more unless I just know that she's just eating to eat and she's not really hungry. Because then we have to give her more enzymes if it's been an hour. Like, for example, the bottle she just ate was about an hour ago. And she's already kind of not over the limit, but she's right at the limit of what she's supposed to get, because this is like the second day that we've upped that dosage. So there's a lot to it. I made a little chart just so I could keep up with her feedings and her diapers, the consistency of the diapers, how many wet diapers she had, how many poopy diapers she had, whether we did her therapy that day. That way, if her grandparents keep her and I'm not there to pick her up and her dad forgets to ask them, or if her dad and I, when I go back to work, are trying to switch off, you know, taking who's going to take care of the baby. Whichever one of us is here with her knows. Excuse me, the last time she ate and if she needs therapy or not. Before one of us goes to sleep or does whatever else we need to do for the night or day. I'm really, really nervous about going back to work because of all of this, but I mean, look at that. She really is the best baby. She can sleep through a hurricane. The dogs bark and she doesn't bat an eyelash. I think every once in a while there will be a noise that makes her have a reflex. But we're so blessed to have her. That is what we're dealing with right now with her cystic fibrosis. We don't have any major complications. She hasn't gotten sick yet. I am dreading the day that she gets her first cold. It terrifies me. My sister, I know I haven't really posted much about it, but my niece was born about 3.5 months early. She was born in June. 2.5 months early. She was born in June. She was due in August. And she spent a lot of time in the NICU. She has MRSA colonized in her body, which is a flesh-eating bacteria, basically. It's like staph and, I can't remember the other word. I used to get it all the time when I was little. It's a skin infection, basically, that's in her blood. So if she has an open sore, she can pass it on to somebody else. It's very contagious. 1 second. Sorry about that. Anyway, additionally, she has a lot of issues with her breathing, where she catches RSV or bronchitis, all kinds of stuff like that. She's had that consistently since she came home, and she's really prone to catching that stuff, so I can't really take Phoenix around her, and I wouldn't have anyway, whether she had cystic fibrosis or not, but that means that we can't spend as much time around my sister as we want to, because all it takes is for one infection and Phoenix will, one infection, Phoenix can die. She can end up in the hospital for weeks or months. Oh, baby, it's okay. Mama's here. It's just really scary to think about that kind of stuff, and that's the reality of our life right now. There are going to be different things that she has as she gets older. She'll eventually have a vest that she can wear that'll beat on her chest for her, so we don't have to do the cup anymore that we use. I hate doing that right now because she's so little. All of the organs are so close to all the major stuff that you can't go over. And she just doesn't like it all the time either. But it's going to really affect her life, and I'm going to try my best to not let it affect her life. And I hope to God that she's one of those kids that gets to live into her 50s or 60s or even longer. And I hope and pray that there's a cure that's found before that even is a problem for her, so that she can be cured and she can just live a happy life and have babies and go to college and get a career that she loves and, you know, see the world and travel and do everything that I never got to do as a young person. I want her to actually live and enjoy her life, and I don't want her to die young. But the reality is that might happen. And so at the end of the day, I have to remember that everything that happens is precious. And I have to do everything I can to be healthy for her. Because if she sees me taking care of myself, she's going to take better care of herself. There's going to be a point where she's 100% responsible for her health, and that's really a big deal with CF. So I'm going to cry. So I'm going to stop filming right now. But that's what's going on in my life right now. So if I don't post a lot of weight loss videos or tips or tricks or stuff like that, that's why. I will try to figure out some things that I haven't touched on before. Right now, a lot of what I'm going to be doing is post weight loss after a baby. Or post baby weight loss. And that is it for now, guys and girls. So thank you for listening, and I hope that this video helps somebody out there that's looking for information on CF to kind of understand, as a new parent to a newborn, what you're looking at. And I hope that it helps, and that I wish you the best. Thanks so much. Reach out to me with any questions or concerns, and I'll talk to you guys later. Bye.